following program is intended for mature audiences.
A Democratic Republic of Sports. The Sportsocracy with ESPN Asheville hosts Tank Spencer and Jeremy Green.
And welcome back into the Wicked Weed studio, wickedweedbrewing.com. Drink different. Tank Spencer and Jeremy Green. We've got your DFS plays for running backs in week one in the NFL. And on the main slate on Sunday, Jeremy, your best play of the week is soon to come.
Well, my best play of the week doesn't have a graphic because we just found out what it was 45 seconds ago.
Tyson Williams.
Yeah, if you don't play Tyson Williams in DraftKings, I don't really know how to help you. Because he's the only living, breathing running back left on the roster.
Mm-hmm.
So there's that. They're playing the Raiders. It's not until Monday. I would honestly play the showdown just to play Tyson Williams. Okay. I hate showdowns. I would do the 16 game slate just to play Tyson Williams. I'm usually a main slate exclusive guy.
Right.
But, oh, good gracious. Baltimore, Latavius Murray. That's all I'm going to say.
Yeah, Latavius Murray. Next up in Baltimore, Le'Veon Bell got signed earlier this week. I don't know if they're going to be able to get him on the team fast enough. I don't know what kind of protocols
they won't be able to get him
to clear.
Tyson yeah. Williams is, I mean, if you're playing the 16-game slate, you're playing the showdown, season long, anything like that. Tyson Williams is a no doubt fire him up this week play.
Oh, they could re-sign Justice Hill.
Justice Hill blew his knee out.
Oh, did he?
Or he didn't blow his knee out.
Oh, I thought they cut him.
No, it was an Achilles injury.
Oh, it was an Achilles
injury. No,
Justice
Hill's hurt.
Oh, okay, he's hurt.
Yeah, Justice Hill's hurt. I mean, they could bring him back on the active roster, but he has the same problem J.K. Dobbins and Gus Edwards have.
Right, I thought he just got outright cut.
No.
So. Yikes. Bad news for the Baltimore running backs. Great news for those of you who went and picked up Tyson Williams in all of your leagues.
I tried to tell you. If you didn't listen, I can't help you.
that you did. So the Gus bus has been derailed. All right, main slate on Sunday, the top plays at running back.
We're starting at 8. My number 8, Raheem Mostert. I don't feel super wonderful about this, but game script tells me that Raheem Mostert's going to be the guy.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see them giving a huge workload to Trey Sermon. I think they're going to blow Detroit's doors off, and Detroit doesn't stop the run well. Raheem Mostert literally needs one big touchdown run to pay off his salary,
mm-hmm.
and I think you're going to get it. Not going to be super high-owned. The closer and closer we get to Sunday, the more I think DraftKings lineups are going to look very similar across the industry. You'll see mm-hmm. one of the high-owned guys later in this list, solely because I don't know how you fade him. But I have an idea of how I'm going to be different.
Okay.
And Raheem Mostert is one of the guys that I could see me playing to be contrarian to the rest of the field.
Yep. Week one, Raheem Mostert, play him while he's healthy. Number 7 on the list. 5,300, you can get Melvin Gordon of the Denver Broncos going up against the New York Giants.
This is not a good run defense. I don't care about your stats. I don't care about your metrics. I don't care. They have improved the secondary. This is going to be a grinded out game. I don't think Denver's ready to hand a gigantic workload to Javonte Williams.
Agreed.
So what does that tell you? Melvin Gordon, last year in Denver, they're going to run him into the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And I could easily see Gordon having 18 to 20 touches in this game. I could see him falling in the end zone twice at 5,300. And this is a guy that's going to be super low owned. According to Pro Football Focus, you're looking at about 1.5% ownership. And he's a guy that could throw up a 20, I can see him having a 20, 25 point game. Just solely because Denver gets out in front and then they just salt the lead away, because I don't think the Giants are going to be able to score on them.
The Atlanta Falcons take on the Philadelphia Eagles. The number 6 running back DFS play this week, Mike Davis, 5,400. Can you not find a cartoon for him?
No, he doesn't have a cartoon.
Oh,
there are certain players.
One.
There are certain players. Mike Davis, he's only been in the league for 40 years.
Yeah, but he's never been relevant until last year.
He is now. Come on, StatMuse. I love your service. I need a cartoon. Mike Davis is a guy you're going to hear a lot of shade at because Philadelphia's line looks so good. I don't care. He's going to be the pass-catching back. I firmly believe that Arthur Smith is going to use Mike Davis in a way that a lot of people don't see coming because he's a good pass catcher. Never had that with Derrick Henry. Derrick Henry's not a plus pass catcher. I'm not saying he can't do it. I'm just saying that's not his best. The best way to use Derrick Henry, Ryan Tannehill turns around, hands the ball to Derrick Henry, lets him get a four-step head start and runs over people. Mike Davis, not quite the same way. He can do that. And against Philadelphia, I think Atlanta is going to beat the bejesus out of them. I see this being a shootout. I think Atlanta's going to get ahead early, and you'll see a lot of work for Mike Davis. They don't have a lot of other guys on the roster. Mm-hmm. I'm not worried about Wayne Gallman. I've been asked that question a ton of times. I don't care. This is a guy that's on his 78th team in 5 years, so I don't care.
When he played last year, he averaged 13 points per game.
Yeah.
That's pretty darn good. Now he's going to be the feature guy.
He's going to be a little higher owned. You're right in that 6-ish percent range for him, which is – that's not that high. He's contrarian enough, and he has – I mean, Mike Davis has 30-point upside. I could easily see him going 6 catches for 40 yards, 100 yards from scrimmage, and a touchdown. That's 26 right there.
Yeah.
So, actually, it's a lot. That's 28. So, that more than pays off his salary. He's the guy I'm finding myself putting in a lot of lineups this week.
At number 5 on this week's DFS Fantasy Plays, at running back, Damian Harris, 5,200, taking on the Miami Dolphins.
One of the things you have to take advantage of with DraftKings early in the season is mispricing, and this is mispriced. Mm-hmm. Damian Harris is now the guy. Don't throw me Ramondre Stevenson. Don't throw me J.J. Taylor. Don't throw me James White. I don't care. With no Cam Newton, this is the guy that's going to get the goal line work predominantly. Not saying you won't see a goal line touch for Ramondre Stevenson, but Damian Harris is going to get the first crack at it.
Right.
And this Miami defense is not overly good. It's a myth that they are. And people, for whatever reason, when I pulled the ownership on Damian Harris, it was 3.5%. I went, yep, I'll have 60-plus percent exposure to him.
Yeah.
And I'm fine with that.
Also with the New England Patriots, with Bill Belichick, how much do you think he's going to trust Mac Jones in the first game? I think he will run the ball a lot.
I think they're going to run the ball a lot. I think he will trust Mac Jones probably more than people think.
Mm-hmm.
This is the first time he's ever started a rookie. There's a reason it's Mac Jones, and it's not because he was put between a rock and a hard place.
Right.
I look at Damian Harris and just say, I think your floor is 3X. I think the floor for Damian Harris is you hit 16. I don't really see a path that he winds up below that. Unless he doesn't score, Ramondre Stevenson falls in the end zone. Because New England's going to score points. They're going to salt this game away. I like Damian Harris against Miami.
The number 4 DFS fantasy play this week is a big hitter. You're going to have to pay up for him, but it could be well worth it. Dalvin Cook, $9,100 as Minnesota Vikings get ready for the Cincinnati Bengals.
You're always going to have – you got to look at ownership of very highly priced guys differently. There's another high-priced running back that's coming later in this segment that's going to get dumb ownership, and he should.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of like having the two highest-priced running backs on the slate. There are enough receivers that we'll have a receiver video coming up for you tomorrow of your place for DraftKings at wide receiver. There's enough cheap guys that I can get up to two big running backs. If you want to be contrarian, because I don't think a lot of people are going to do that, I think the ownership on Dalvin Cook will be in that 15 to 20% range. McCaffrey's going to be in that 25 to 30 range. The percentage of having them both is, I would say, below 2%.
Mm-hmm. Last year, there were 11 running backs against the Cincinnati Bengals that went at least 80 yards rushing, and there were 10 of them that hit pay dirt in one form or fashion.
Mm-hmm. I will say Cincinnati, in my opinion, is better against the run than they are against the pass, looking at the defense as it's currently constructed.
Mm-hmm.
I just see Minnesota getting ahead in this game and Dalvin Cook seeing a tremendous workload.
Number 3, Antonio Gibson. One of my favorite plays forever and always.
He's mispriced.
Mm-hmm. Washington football team, $5,900 for Antonio Gibson.
The one thing I will say is that there's another player that's the number one on this video that's priced similarly and is going to have a higher workload. Antonio Gibson's going to get split somewhat between Jaden McKissick, Jerry Patterson, and himself. I'm not saying it's a huge split. He'll be the head of the snake, no doubt. I just think there's another running back that's similarly priced, playing in a better matchup, and he's going to get all of the workload. Now, that being said, Antonio Gibson's a PPR guy. I do think they're going to use him more in the passing game. Rivera has said in the offseason that they want to use him in that CMC role.
Yep.
I don't really believe that. if that was really true, your backup running back would not be J.D. McKissic. So I just don't buy it. I think he will accelerate the passing game a little bit, but it's not going to be to the level of what people think. But he is mispriced. He should be in the 7,000 range.
I'd agree.
And he's at 5,900 against a Chargers team that there is a possibility that game shoots out. I don't think it will, but there's a possibility it will.
Probably the last week you'll find him under 6,000.
Oh, absolutely.
Christian McCaffrey is number two. He's the number one running back that you're going to have to pay for. $9,500 this week, and they're going up against your New York Jets, Jeremy, in Bank of America Stadium. McCaffrey played three games last year, scored six touchdowns. I'm going to leave my part there.
The thing I will tell you to be wary of with Christian McCaffrey is that the Jets increase the speed on defense exponentially. They're now playing two safeties at linebacker. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure that you're going to see him be – he'll be a factor in the passing game. At 20-plus percent ownership at his price, he's going to have to go 35-plus, and I'm not sure he can hit that. I think that's a tall ask against this Jets team. Sam Darnold's going to press the ball down the field because the Jets secondary is a joke. Mm-hmm. They're starting three rookies. Well, two rookies and a guy that started half the year last year.
Right.
Coming off a knee injury in Bryce Hall. So I look at the Panthers and go, yes, that's a team I want to attack. Yes, I want to have shares of Christian McCaffrey because I think he's going to be the highest scorer on the slate. I just don't know. He's not a guy that I'm going to shoehorn into my lineups.
Yeah.
There are going to be a lot of places where I have the guy that's number one on this list, Antonio Gibson and Mike Davis or Damian Harris or whatever the case may be. Another cheaper third flex, and then I spend up at receiver because I think that will be contrarian this week.
And number one on the
with a bullet
on the DFS plays for the week, taking on the Houston Texans of the Jacksonville Jaguars, it's James Robinson. $6,400 is all you have to spend for him, and he will probably have a 120-yard game this week.
I think he's going to kill the Texans because I think Jacksonville's going to blow the Texans out because they're not very good.
Mm-hmm.
Tyrod Taylor has never been – he's efficient. He won't put you in bad positions. This team's bad. James Robinson's the only running back. I'm not overly worried about Carlos Hyde with no Travis Etienne. I just don't see anybody cutting into the workload. And you don't know what this offense is going to look like. Here's what I can tell you you're not going to see. You're not going to see Trevor Lawrence come in and throw 45 times. They're going to try to do everything in their power to make this easier on the rookie. When I saw 3.6% ownership on James Robinson, according to Pro Football Focus, I went, well, that's dumb. Mm-hmm. And I think it will be higher than that.
Yeah, I
just
do too.
Throwing that out there. With no Gus Edwards in the 16-game slates, with all of the instability with what happens with the Lions, what happens with whatever the case may be, you're going to see some of these safer running backs become more popular than the ownership projections say. I like James Robinson. You can tell me he's 10% owned. I'm all the way in.
Yeah.
Because I need him to hit 3X to feel pretty good about my chances for cashing, 4X if I want to feel really good in a tournament. And I'll be honest with you, I could see a path that he goes ham. Not a huge factor in the passing game, but they don't have anybody else that's a factor in the passing game either.
Right.
Laviska Shenault is going to be used as the dump-off guy. They don't have a tight end. And you got to wonder, was the fact that James Robinson wasn't involved in the passing game a Doug Marrone thing or a he can't catch passes thing?
Last year, the Houston Texans surrendered per game 33 points to opposing running backs. Per game.
Insane.
That is crazy.
And they're worse now than they were last year.
Yeah. James Robinson needs to be owned. He needs to be started in all of your DFS lineups. I completely agree with that.
He's my number one running back on the week.
Yep.
That now gives us quarterbacks and running backs on the week one DraftKings player pool. We will have a receiver video coming out tomorrow. That'd be Friday. And then we'll have tight ends and defenses done on one show for Saturday. Mm-hmm. And that will give you my entire player pool for week one in DraftKings.
And don't forget about our DraftKings winner take half contest. It's a 50-50 split. Main slate winner will get 50% of the winnings, and the other 50% goes to our charity of the year, Eblen Charities St. Nicholas Project. Get in on the game today. There are, correct, two different games?
Correct. There's a $5 and there's a $20. You can go to our website, thesportsocracy.com, and you will see on the homepage there are little buttons. All you have to do is click one of those, pay with. You can pay PayPal, Cash App, Venmo, however you so choose. Just make sure in the comments you leave the DK username that you want to use, and I'll send an invite to you.
Excellent. Winner take half. Register at thesportsocracy.com. Again, you get half, and half goes to Eblen Charities St. Nicholas Project. I'm Tank Spencer. He's Jeremy Green. We'll have wide receivers still to go, tight ends, and defense as well coming up later on in the week before we get to Sunday's main slate.
And be sure to check us out on Sunday. It will be recorded because we will be in the stadium for the Jets and the Panthers at Bank of America Stadium. But we will give you all of our rankings, all of our things. They'll be out on the channel. Just be sure to click the like and subscribe button so you can see everything we to make you all the money.
That's right. Check us out at thesportsocracy.com. Until next time, be good.